Hot Seat, we're discussing trafficking of Ugandan women, hoping that they're going to look for jobs or they're going to be given jobs in Malaysia and ending up working as prostitutes, managed by pimps who take them from here and turn them into sex slaves. We have about 1,300 Ugandans living in Malaysia now.
Yes.
Most of them students.
Yes. 600 are real students in my universities.
Mm. And then?
And the rest are the so-called students.
So-called students.
Who studied English for one day a month.
Are there networks operating in Kampala? Where are they? Who's running them? How high do they go?
You cannot have this kind of business if you are not highly organized. It's called in transnational organized crime. It is now so highly organized that one person will travel today, another person will travel tomorrow, another person will travel next week. Trafficking in human beings is a crime, a violation against the person. Some countries are a source, other countries are transit, while others are countries of destination. Uganda is majorly a country of source. We have also experienced Uganda as a final destination country. About 600 Ugandan girls in Malaysia alone. 300 suspected to be in India. We have other countries: Thailand, China, Indonesia, United Arab Emirates, especially Dubai, in Iraq, Egypt, and some in Denmark. The victims are intimidated to say anything. First and foremost, it involves selection of vulnerable girls. They are tricked by supposedly progressive, you know, Ugandan girls driving very good cars. They just track you. They get information about you. They know you are a graduate. They know you are working in a saloon, maybe for 2 or 3 years. You're getting. They know where you sleep. They know the kind of acquaintances you have, and it's not a mistake that they pinpoint you out. They just come to you and then they say, "Look at how I am. I mean, I also went through this. But if you don't have money, don't worry. We shall organize a passport for you. If you don't have, we shall organize air ticket for you. We shall organize for you some little amount of money." There is a lot of intimidation that is being used. First of all, they take them to shrines. Okay? Then they cut some hair from maybe pubic hair or under their armpits and that kind of thing. Then they cut the nails. Which doctor, they say, if you ever say anything, you will die. There is also another method. This is through supposedly legal businesses, employment agencies. They are located most places in Kampala. Namaganda Plaza, Avema, Pioneer Shopping Malls. Yes, you'll find posters there that there is a company recruiting people to go to Malaysia, find work in Malaysia. They put their telephone numbers and that kind of thing.
Are Ugandans actually able to find jobs in Malaysia?
No.
Why?
Except for professionals. If their qualification is having masters, PhDs, then they can apply to companies. And if the companies wants to take them, it is the company's responsibility to apply to immigration for their work permit. And once that work permit is approved, then only this gentleman or lady can come to Malaysia to work.
It's true that some of the people that are taken, some go and find employment. They can easily say, okay, if you're not sure, ring so and so. And they will ring, and this person will say, okay, I'm in Dubai, I'm in Malaysia, I'm in India, and I'm getting money.
Yeah.
Okay? So this gives you like an impetus. The girls that we have talked to, that you find some of their relatives being involved.
It's about $9,000 that you're bonded to. That's about 20 million Uganda shillings. And you go to work until you recover that cost.
Yes.
And never pay it back fully.
No, you'll never. They will always have a reason to keep you in bondage.
Just stop the girls from coming over.
Okay.
Because there's no job, except for if you are a qualified Makariri doctors, then you have jobs in Malaysia.